Hey guys, welcome to Best Movie Recap. Today I'm going to explain a 2011 American action movie called Captain America. Warning! Spoilers ahead, watch out and take care. Today's movie starts with scientists in the Arctic uncovering an old frozen aircraft. While investigating the aircraft's interior, two of the researchers discover a frozen circular object. In March 1942, Hydra forces led by Johan Schmidt invade a stone church in Tønsberg, Norway, seeking a mysterious cosmic artifact known as the Tesseract, which possesses an untold power. The soldiers couldn't find it, but then Schmidt show up and open a sarcophagus within. He finds the skeletal remains clutching a glass cube. The guard pleads for Schmidt to leave it, but Schmidt scoffs and said this cube would be the jewel of Odin's treasury if it weren't a fake. Then he smashes it on the floor and goes to the guard asking him where the real cube is hidden. The guard initially refuses to tell him, but under threat of harm to his family, he pointed to a hidden staircase in a stone panel on the wall. Schmidt opens the drawer and finds the real glowing cube concealed within. After that, Schmidt orders his men to shell the city and then shoots the guard. A year later in 1943, Steve Rogers is once again rejected for military duty on the battlefields of World War II, despite making multiple attempts at different enlistment offices, due to his frail physical appearance and numerous health issues. After that, Steve heads to watch a movie in the cinema. He envies the enlisted men featured in the pre-show newsreel. Suddenly an impatient moviegoer begins yelling at the screen, "Start the movie. I didn't pay to see this crap." Rogers, who deeply respects the soldiers, tells him to shut up. Then the man turns around and heads towards Steve. In the alley behind the theater, the bully savagely beats the scrawny Steve, who bravely fights back, but is easily overpowered. When his opponent asks him why he won't simply give up, Rogers says, "I can do this all day." Suddenly Steve's best friend James Bucky Barnes comes running to the alley. He swiftly kicks the bully away and tends to Rogers, who is annoyed that Bucky showed up and got rid of the bully. James is now an enlisted man, his application was accepted and he's been assigned to the 107th Infantry. Then Bucky invites Steve to go dancing with a pair of girls on a double date. While attending Stark's show with Bucky, Steve breaks away from the group and goes to another recruiting station. James catches up with him and asks how Steve intends to forge his application this time. Unbeknownst to both of them, Dr. Abraham Erskine was passing and eavesdropping on their conversation. He is fascinated by Steve's gumption. Bucky wishes Steve good luck on his latest application and leave. Steve heads into the recruiting station for his fifth time. Inside the station, Steve sits on an examination table and grows nervous when an MP enters the room, then followed by Dr. Abraham Erskine, who has all of Steve's prior applications on file. Concerned by Steve's failed applications, Erskine tests his character by asking if his insistence on applying for military service is driven purely by a desire to kill Nazis. The young man sincerely reveals that he is not a killer at heart, but he does not like bullies regardless of their origin. Impressed by Steve's strong will and unwavering conviction, Dr. Erskine allows Rogers to enlist. He is recruited into the Strategic Scientific Reserve as part of a super soldier experiment under the supervision of Erskine. The next day, Rogers has been enlisted into basic training under the careful watch of Dr. Erskine and Colonel Chester Phillips. He and his platoon are told that they are candidates for the government's latest super soldier program. Phillips is unimpressed with Steve and is vexed by Dr. Erskine's interest in him. During the basic training, Rogers meets a beautiful British officer named Peggy Carter, who seems to pity him. Despite being the smallest and weakest of the platoon, Steve demonstrates the greatest spirit, selflessness, and ingenuity, especially when his platoon is charged with retrieving a flag from the top of a tall pole. All the fit men try to climb up the pole, but they fail in the task one by one. Rogers, who was the last one, pulls the pin holding it up and then takes the flag when the pole crashes to the ground. Phillips, who was still unconvinced, tosses a grenade into the group during calisthenics and they all scatter except Rogers, who leaps on top of it, willing to sacrifice himself to save the others, before discovering that the grenade was a dummy. After that, Phillips concedes to Erskine's decision. Later on that night, Erskine reveals to Rogers that Schmidt underwent an imperfect version of the procedure and suffered negative side effects due to his inner ambition for power and obsession with becoming a superior man. However, he reassures Rogers that he chose him because he believed Rogers was an inherently good man and because he had been weak his whole life, so he would not lose respect for the strength he would gain. Back in Europe, Schmidt and Dr. Zola were using one of his machines which successfully harnessed the energies of the Tesseract with the intent to use this power to fuel Zola's inventions. After that, Schmidt discovered Erskine's location, and sent an assassin to kill him. The next day, Rogers and Peggy wind their way through Brooklyn and come to a stop in front of an old antique shop. Along the way, Steve points out various parts in Brooklyn where he's been beaten up. She asks him why he never runs away. He responds that running away in his mind is an invitation for further abuse. The two enter the antique shop and exchange passcodes with an old woman manning the register. After that, they descend into a secret military bunker concealed within. Peggy leads Steve to the heart of the bunker where they find Dr. Erskine preparing a medical capsule along with Howard Stark and Colonel Phillips with senators and dignitaries. Rogers is told to remove his shirt and sit in the capsule. Then Stark starts describing that the procedure will first mean injecting muscle regenerators into Rogers' major muscle groups, which will then be bombarded with the Vita rays. Erskine has made no secret of the pain Steve will endure but promises he'll come out stronger. Erskine's serum is injected into Steve's muscles and Rogers is enclosed within the Vita ray capsule. The capsule glows brightly, and Steve starts yelling in pain but also tells them to continue and the procedure is quickly completed. When the capsule opens, Rogers comes out a foot taller and 100 pounds heavier with solid muscle, which is just the most superficial aspect of his body artificially raised to the maximum human potential. After witnessing the success of the experiment, one of the attendees named Heinz Kruger reveals himself to be Schmidt's assassin. He shoots Erskine, killing him, then he grabs the last vial of the super soldier serum and escapes the facility into the streets. Rogers uses his new strength and stamina to run after Kruger's car on foot. Despite attempting to escape in a submarine, Rogers manages to catch Kruger, but the vial of the super soldier serum is broken in the process and the assassin immediately commits suicide by cyanide pill before he can be interrogated for information. With Erskine dead and the super soldier formula lost, the SSR is ordered to join the war and engage Hydra directly. However, Phillips decides to leave Rogers behind and allow scientists to study him in an attempt to rediscover Erskine's formula. Senator Brandt approaches Rogers and offers him the chance to tour the nation for the United Service Organizations to promote war donations, using his image as the strong ideal soldier as a symbol for the public to rally behind, which Rogers accepts. During his work for the USO, Rogers performs in scripted stage shows as the star-spangled character Captain America. As Rogers continues touring across the country, Captain America gains great popularity among the public. Although Rogers is happy to be contributing to the war effort, deep inside he feels sad for not participating in the war with the real fighters. Meanwhile, Schmidt and Dr. Zola are visited by a trio of Hitler's top commanders, tasked with inspecting Schmidt's operation. They ridicule Schmidt, saying that the Nazi party will no longer take him and Hydra seriously due to his obsession with magic. They playfully refer to him as the Red Skull, a name that infuriates Schmidt. He takes the three to his weapons lab where they are shown his unstoppable energy weapons and a strategic map of Europe dotted with targets. One of the three notices a target hovering over Berlin and confronts Schmidt, who quickly vaporizes the three Nazi officers. Schmidt announces that Hydra has disbanded from the Nazi party, it is now the enemy of the world. He also claims that Hydra could grow no further in Hitler's shadow. In November 1943, Steve is taken to Italy, where he continues entertaining the troops. Upon his arrival, the surly and war-torn men tease him and tell him to get off the stage and bring back the girls. After that, he meets Peggy, who along with Phillips is overseeing the European theater of the war. She tells him that the men are unhappy because many from their division, the 107th Infantry, have been killed in battle. Rogers realizes that this is Bucky's division, and quickly runs to see Phillips, who was unable to find Bucky's name on his casualty list. Then he tells Steve to go back to his job as a movie star and a cheerleader. Rogers asks Peggy where the men and Bucky are being held. She shows him a map and a known Hydra weapons factory 30 to 40 miles behind the enemy lines. He aims to steal a jeep and drive into Hydra's backyard, but Peggy, who believes in him, has a better idea. She asks Howard Stark to fly them both over the battlefield in his private plane. Steve surmises that Stark and Carter have a relationship and bashfully withholds his feelings for her. Just as anti-aircraft guns from Hydra begin firing on Stark's plane, Rogers parachutes in, while the other two escape back to safety. Steve stealthily makes his way into the Hydra base, taking out numerous guards in the process. Schmidt, seeing the prisoners escaping and Rogers moving through the facility, sets the factory to self-destruct to cover Hydra's operations and evacuate to another facility. As the building begins to detonate, Schmidt confronts Rogers on a high catwalk where he makes light of his similarities to Rogers following their mutual use of the super soldier serum. Schmidt expresses his belief that they have risen above the visage of normal humans before revealing his face to be a mask, removing it to display the Red Skull face that earned him the sobriquet the Red Skull. Schmidt and Zola make their escape while Rogers leads Bucky to the roof, where they both barely manage to escape the factory themselves before regrouping with the escaped soldiers and marching back to base. Following the liberation of the Allied prisoners, Rogers gains his superior officer's respect and acknowledgement as a soldier and is given high rank and the chance to fight as Captain America, as a key figure on the war front opposing Hydra directly. Howard Stark outfits Rogers with advanced equipment, including a durable custom combat uniform and a circular shield made of vibranium. For the next 2 years, Captain America and his soldiers, including Bucky, make their way across Europe, flattening Hydra's bases one by one, with Rogers becoming quite skilled at using the shield as a projectile weapon. News of his exploits reaches the Red Skull and Zola. The Skull is furious, referring to Rogers as a simpleton with a shield, then he gets angry and murders the last man alive at one of his destroyed facilities. In 1945, the team later assaults a train carrying Zola. Rogers and Barnes engage in a fight with the soldiers on the train, during which Bucky is tossed from the train and plummets into an icy river below, while Jones locates Zola on the train and captures him. Rogers is deeply affected by the loss of his best friend and is convinced by Peggy to use his sorrow as motivation to put an end to Hydra for good. The next day, Rogers and his team prepare a battle plan to take down the Red Skull at his headquarters. Rogers, dressed in a new uniform, then take his Harley and headed to the base. He easily dodges Hydra soldiers and tanks and finds himself within the base, surrounded by a Hydra army. He is taken into custody and led to the Red Skull's private weapons lab. The Red Skull asks what makes Steve so special. Steve says nothing, I'm just a kid from Brooklyn, moments before members of his team zipline into the Red Skull's office. A climactic firefight ensues, as hundreds of soldiers under the direction of Phillips and Carter storm the base, killing many Hydra soldiers. The Red Skull flees to his private hangar, in which a giant flying wing powered by the Tesseract is preparing to take off. Steve attempts to catch up with the plane on foot but is unable. Suddenly Phillips and Peggy arrive in the Skull's roadster, and the three take off after the plane. Rogers leaps from the roadster onto one of the plane's massive wheels. He sneaks into the craft, where he finds dozens of kamikaze Planis missiles, each labeled with a different major American city. Hydra soldiers soon enter the room and Steve battles them, taking out numerous man and tiny planes. One of the planes labeled New York drops free. Steve takes off after it and manages to commandeer the craft and crashes it back into the flying wing after throwing the pilot through its rearward mounted propeller. Inside the large cockpit, Captain America and the Red Skull have a fisticuffs battle. The Red Skull fires his cube energy pistol at Steve, who easily deflects the shots using his shield. A shot is deflected into one of the cockpit's center consoles, which contains the glowing blue cube. The console is damaged and Skull lifts the cube into the air. Suddenly a portal opens above him, showing starry space. The Red Skull glows brightly and is seemingly disintegrated. His remains are swept up into the cosmos. The cube, still glowing brightly, drops to the ground and burns its way down through the plane's hull before plummeting into the ocean below. Rogers mans the plane's controls and radios Peggy. He tells her that the plane is on a flight path that will take them to the eastern seaboard. Then he tells her that their dance will have to wait. After that, he pushes the plane into a dive and crashes it into a glacier below. Rogers awakens in a 1940s-style hospital room. Deducing from an anachronistic radio broadcast that he was out of place then, he flees outside into what is revealed to be the present-day Times Square, where Nick Fury tells him that he has been asleep for nearly 70 years. Stunned by this revelation, Rogers' only response was that he had a date. Thanks for watching. Make sure you hit the like button and turn on the notification bell for more videos.